New rules on pardon and parole are set to be published on May 15th that will enable more prisoners in Philippine prisons to qualify for early release. Supreme Court Chief Justice Diosdado Peralta also approved the pilot testing of video conference hearings for urgent matters, including bail hearings. Former Supreme Court spokesperson Theodore Te joins us now on the program to share his insights on efforts to decongest Philippine prison facilities during this pandemic. Tony Teddy, magandang hapon sa inyo. How are you?
Good afternoon, Tony. I'm very well, thank you. I hope you're well too.
Yeah, thank you for mentioning that. And of course, I'm joined here by my colleague Nikki De Guzman this afternoon. Well, first of all, let's talk about, you know, how urgent it is to actually decongest Philippine prisons. We've been talking to prison officials, you know, for the past 2 weeks and asking them whether or not the congestion in Philippine jails is a cause of concern and whether or not it could lead to a further spread of the COVID-19 disease. In your view, just how urgent is it to actually lessen the number of inmates now?
Well, I think it really is an urgent issue. I don't think anyone will quarrel with that. All of us are trying our best to maintain physical distancing in order to flatten the curve, as it were. And the prisons are, you know, are the exact opposite of that. There is really no place to maintain any sort of effective physical distancing there. Even before this pandemic came in, we've already been talking about over-congested prisons. We've already been talking about inmates occupying a land area that really was not designed to occupy that number. So, you know, it really is a matter of urgent concern. One person I spoke with described it, I think, quite well. It is a petri dish for the COVID infection because you know, it will spread very easily because they are overcrowded and there are too many people inside.
Yeah. And so, you know, with that situation prevailing now, how do we choose or how can the legal system choose which inmates or which group of inmates can be allowed to actually, you know, get out of the prison facility?
Yeah. Theoretically, that shouldn't be very difficult because there should be classifications already that are known to prison officials, which offenders are the so-called low-risk offenders. These are people, for example, who don't have a history. They are charged or convicted of very light offenses, very light felonies, for example. Or these are people who, during the time that they were in jail, have good records. You know, have shown genuine reasons why they should be let go early. There are also people in jail who are detained. They are not yet convicted. They are detained for bailable offenses, but they were not set free because they could not afford the bail. So these are, I think, classifications of inmates or convicts even that are known or should be known to prison officials. And so ito yung pwedeng una eh. Pwedeng unang wave, no? These are the low-risk people. And then, of course, it can get into the further classification yung sa mga medyo mahabang sentensya. Then that's when a certain siguro level of criteria should come in. No? How do we now determine how to further decongest the prisons if we're talking already about more serious offenses? And even, for example, those offenses that are very, very serious, there has to be a way to maintain an effective physical distancing. Kung hindi man sila palayain outright, then there has to be, I think, thought given to where do we put them in the meantime. No, I think may mga binanggit kanina si Ed Olalia in the part of the interview that I heard. And I agree with that. There can be measures, for example, in the meantime. Now, without releasing them, no, maybe transferring them to an area where they can maintain physical distancing. Maybe arenas, maybe you know, large football fields. You can still maintain. You can still maintain a measure of security there. Yeah. You can place tents. You can put them in, you know, in designated quarters. No, possible yun eh, because of what's going on now. Schools. There are schools that are no longer being used because walang pasok na yun because of COVID. That can still be that. they can be housed there, for example. No? So ito yung mga paraan na pwedeng tingnan. But the idea here, no, is not just to release everyone outright, but to find a way to decongest the prison.
Yeah, and you're talking. You're talking about low risk detainees or inmates. No, so I read, you know, another opinion piece by another lawyer who was talking about a point system. You know, how you can actually ascribe points, no, to a particular inmate, and whether or not yung score niya would qualify him for, you know, early release or even temporary release.
Possible yun, except that of course our authorities have to agree first na gagawin yun, no? But again, that might already be too late. We're actually playing catching up now, eh, no? Kasi at the first instance dapat na set in place na ito, kasi nga vulnerable sector yan, eh. Kasi they're crowded, they're congested, no? So I think the quickest way really is to look at the list of low risk inmates, no? Unahin na ito, no? Unahin na yung mga yan, those that are in jail who could not afford bail because for some reason that's why they're still in jail, unahin na yan. Those who have already served the minimum of the sentence, even if they will be convicted. Kasi may maraming ganun.
Yeah.
Palayain na yan.
Yeah.
Yung mga ganun. That's data that's available, I think.
Attorney Ted, talk to us about the feasibility of conducting bail hearings during this situation. Are the courts actually allowed to hold bail hearings using electronic means?
There is a new circular, Tony, by the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, 37/2020. The Supreme Court has issued a series of circulars since the ECQ started, and in one of the latest, the court has actually allowed through a pilot test, no, of all courts covered by the circular, video conferencing, which includes bail hearings, which includes urgent petitions. No, but of course, again, kinahabol na yun yung technical requirements, because our courts were not designed to primarily do virtual service. No, ang idea ng korte natin is physical, face to face. No, but since it really does not allow the court to operate now on a physical basis, kailangan mag-adjust ka agad. And so yes, the Supreme Court has now allowed virtual service, basically, you know, online maybe hearings. But again, the technical requirements are still being put in, as far as I understand. So judges have to quickly, you know, adapt,
you know? Yeah.
There's a learning curve there, no? Hindi lahat ng tao sanay dito sa technology. Not only judges, lawyers, prosecutors, no? Even litigants, kailangan humabol ka agad dun sa issue na yon, of technology being used for law, no? For legal processes. Pero kailangan kasi.
But I understand, Attorney Ten, no, during the time of then Supreme Court Justice Maria Lourdes Serrano, that they were already implementing an e-court system. Even yung records, you know, were supposed to be, accessible through electronic means. So somehow, hindi ba natuloy yung system, yung work being done at that time, dahil natanggal si Chief Justice?
Hindi naman. E-court system is primarily a case management system. It's to keep track of cases. This one, itong inalaw ng court ngayon under 37/2020, is primarily a hearing system. Magkaiba.
Yeah.
So this one will allow, for example, we're using technology now, Zoom, no, to communicate with each other. It will allow the courts to do this now.
Yeah.
But the e-court system was really a way to keep track digitally and online of the cases. So iba yung ano yun. As far as I know, tinutuloy pa rin naman ng yung ibang programa under the old system.
Yeah.
They're being procured, no? May process of any procurement of technology services, etc. But this one, this is different, no? If we read the circular, merong in-specify na technology and that's required of all the courts. So the courts will have to learn very quickly what that technology means and how they can use it.
And they have to be, in a sense, retrofitted to actually employ, you know, digital means, no, of holding these hearings.
That's the perfect term, Tony. Mm. Retrofit. You know, you have to adapt to it. The structure was not built for this, mm. but you have to, you know, basically force it in and redesign it.
Yeah.
While without destroying the structure. Mm. So tama yung term na yun. Retrofit talaga yung ginagawa dito. Mm.
And in, you know, we're talking about the short term, you know, because of course the urgency with which we have to address the congestion in the jails and how to be able to quickly choose who are qualified for, you know, early release or temporary release. But in the long term, we're looking at jail congestion as a perpetual problem being faced by the penal system. In your view, how should this be addressed? Since we're looking at a new normal where congestion is definitely going to be risky for all of these inmates.
How long do you have, Tony? It's a huge problem, and it cannot just be handled by one department. Mm-hmm. You know, it's really not up to the courts alone. It involves, for example, Congress looking at laws, for example, that there may be two laws that provide for imprisonment mm. as a penalty, no? Kaya dahil doon, maraming napupunta sa kulungan mm. and our jails get congested. I'm not saying huwag silang parusahan. Mm. What I'm saying is there are ways we can hold people accountable criminally without sending them to jail. For example, fines, no? Huge fines that will be big enough to hurt mm-hmm. and to teach a lesson without, for example, going up beyond the constitutional provision of excessive fines.
For example, because you're going into the realm of parang choosing which penalties might not require mm. imprisonment, could you give us an idea? I mean, legally, what would constitute parang an offense that would not have to be parang penalized with imprisonment?
For example, you can put offenses. That will be lighter offenses. No?
Oh, okay.
You can put progressions. For example, first offense, mm. ito muna. Second Why? Offense, ito pangalawa. Mm. Third offense, imprisonment. No?
Okay.
Many ordinances do that. No? And then some of the offenses, for example, that may involve purely monetary injury.
Mm.
No?
A bouncing check. Well, ganun. Estafa.
Bouncing checks, for example. Mm. Yes. Pwedeng fines yun. No? Huge fines rather than imprisonment.
Mm.
So, again, this is a conversation that should be had at the level of Congress. No,
mm-hmm.
Why? Because if we keep having laws that provide imprisonment as the main penalty, the
yeah.
judges will have no choice.
Of course.
The judges will have to impose imprisonment.
Yeah.
So more and more people will go to jail.
Yeah.
And so the jails will not increase in size. Eh.
Yeah.
Dumadami yung
kuwarta. Yung mga simpleng kaso na nagnakaw ng sampay, kulong.
Yung mga ganon.
Uh-huh.
May mga imprisonment yun eh.
Uh-huh.
No? So even if you stay 6 months in jail.
Shoplifting.
And so, 6 months pa rin yun.
Uh-huh. Right?
6 months pa rin yun. So that's one. Second, the manner of release. No.
Mm.
Again, the monitoring. We need to be able to have a system where in records, court records should coincide with prosecution records, should coincide with jail records. So that isa yung monitoring.
Mm.
Kasi yung court ang nagsasentensya. Alam ng court kung gaano kahaba
mm.
yung sinintensya niya.
Mm.
But the jails, no, will pick that up.
Yeah.
Pagpasok na sa jail system,
yeah.
dapat alam din na jail, mapaklag din. Yung mga ganun, no? So it's quite complex. No? It's not a very simple problem.
Yeah.
It would involve conversations with Congress. It would involve conversations with in the executive department,
mm.
for example, the DOJ definitely,
mm.
because the DOJ is in charge of the prosecution as well as the defense. No?
Mm.
It will involve, for example, the Bureau of Correction,
yeah.
the Bureau of Jail Management and Pathology,
mm.
even PNP, for example. No?
Yeah.
Yung mga ganon. It's something that needs to be looked at for the medium and the long term, because we've already seen how urgent the need is now
mm.
because of this COVID-19. And I don't think mga kabalik tayo doon sa dati pa eh. And
yeah.
I don't think dapat bumalik tayo sa dati. This
mm.
is a good opportunity
mm.
to take a look at the problem and try to, you know, get a handle on how to not solve it directly because
yeah.
it cannot be solved immediately,
mm.
but how to avoid, you know,
mm.
going back to the problem and exacerbating the problem.
Mm. Attorney Tan, I just want to go back to a point or a suggestion that you actually made, you know, a few minutes ago. You're talking about temporarily moving out inmates who are low risk and transferring them to temporary detention areas like maybe unused schools or unused sports stadiums. And what do you think maybe would the reaction be of the communities within those areas where the schools and sports stadiums are located? Hindi kaya parang katulad nung dinala yung mga OFWs na i-quarantine sa New Clark City, natakot ngayon yung mga local citizens doon because they think, oh come on, you're bringing people who may pose a security risk to my area.
Well, again, you know, if you're talking about low-risk people, these are offenses that are very, very minor.
Oh, pero may stigma, very, very light. May stigma pa rin yun eh. Kasi galing kulungan yun.
That's true. And unfortunately, that is something, you know, it will have to be addressed. You know, the reason why people are sent to jail is partly to rehabilitate them. Mm-hmm. You know? And so, dapat nakikita yung epekto na yun eh. Dapat yung jails yung nagsasabi na kami na yung nagsasabi na na-rehabilitate na yan. Huwag na kayo matakot dyan. Mm-hmm. No? If our prison authorities cannot with confidence say that, then I think that's another problem. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. That's another problem. Yeah. And you know, there are other ways, for example, to put them to good use, to put them to productive use. No? Pwede silang itap as volunteers, for example. Hindi siya pwede pilitin, pwede silang itap as volunteers to help out in many of these things. So, again, hindi natin maiwasan that people might think, no, matakot sila, people might think, of course, these are criminals, no, the convicted people. No? Mm-hmm. But again, the idea of low-risk people, no, mm-hmm. some of the offenses are really, really light. No? Mm-hmm. Some of the offenses are, actually, if you look at it, quite mm-hmm. trivial. Mm-hmm. No? But again, they may be in jail because they could not afford bail. Mm-hmm. They may be in jail and they may have extended their time in jail kaya hindi sila nakalabas.
Yeah.
So these are properly people who should really be out, no, not in jail.
Okay.
And then of course, one other thing siguro, there are humanitarian considerations. So there are people who are sick.
Yes.
There are people who should not be in jail because they are sick. Maybe not of COVID, but they become more vulnerable because of their health condition, no? So yung mga yon, first priority dapat ilabas yon kasi otherwise magdadagdag din ang problema.
And maybe just to close up, when we talk about the design, no, of our prison facilities and how we actually cram inmates, as you said nga, parang yung per square meter, parang yung occupancy wasn't actually designed for that many people. Do you think that the government should actually look seriously into, you know, making better prison facilities? Not that we want more prisoners, but we actually want to treat prisoners humanely and to give them better health, you know, parang better sanitary conditions.
Well, that's one solution. To continue to improve prison facilities. There is what we call a minimum set of conditions issued by the United Nations for treatment of prisoners, no? And it is universally accepted, no? In fact, they're called the Nelson Mandela rules. And so in recognition of Nelson Mandela, who spent a long time in jail, no? So ito yung mga minimum standards na sinasabi ng UN na kinikilala natin na dapat yung jails natin ganitong level to at the very least address human dignity, because I think the standard here is a human rights standard. The standard is human dignity. Even if they are convicted, even if they are in jail, no, they're convicted of a crime, no, hindi nawawala dapat yung human dignity na eh. And so if the prison conditions allow a degradation of human dignity, then the purpose for rehabilitation cannot be achieved eh. Hindi talaga kaya.
So do we actually see any implementation of the Nelson Mandela rule in our Philippine prisons?
Well, you know, I cannot generalize. No, I think our prison officials are doing their best. No? But that's a complex set of problems. For example, it starts with, of course, as we very well know, budget. It starts with priorities. It starts with, you know, all of those considerations why they are congested in the first place. Mm-hmm. No? Lahat yan nagkakapatong-patong eh. If you're the administrator of the jail, malamang hindi mo alam kung alin yung unahin mong problema kasi lahat yan urgent na. Kumbaga, quadrant one lahat yan.
Mm-hmm.
No? So, it's complex. I would like to think that our prison officials are, you know, trying their best to to adhere to these minimum standards. But again, the physical reality is if you cram people, you know, into a space that's really not designed for it, then already there are effects that will happen.
Exactly. Attorney Nikki De Guzman has a question for you.
Hi, sir. Just asking, so these people who will be released to their families, will they be undergoing another round of testing before they are released? Or will they be under quarantine? Will there be an attending physician who will be giving some sort of parang clearance po to them to say that they will be, they are okay in terms of health to go back to their families? Attorney.
Oh.
Yes, Paul.
Sure, we're speaking, you know, I'm speaking as a former court official, you know, and I really have no influence over how they are released. But I would like to think, if they are being released primarily because of the pandemic, and then of course, kailangan i-safeguard din yung health ng ibang tao, no? So at the very least, minimum dyan is self-quarantine for 14 days, no? So dapat meron ding way to ensure that they can self-quarantine before they are released to their family, back to their families. In fact, may isang problema pa nag-aaray dyan ni Kia. Kasi let's say if you're in the national penitentiary in Muntinlupa, no? That's national. So may ibang inmates doon galing sa ibang probinsya. Mm-hmm. Wala dito yung pamilya nila. So pag ni-release mo, saan mo sila dadalhin? Paano sila uuwi? Diba? Yun yung problema dyan eh. So any measure that will allow this release, no, has to be very well calibrated to take that into account. No, yung pag ni-release mo sila, hindi mo sila i-release tapos parang bayaan mo na lang. No, eh talagang dapat matatakot talaga yung publiko dyan. Na parang, eh paano kung may sakit yan? Right? So kasama yun. No? So the release, pag pinasos yan, dapat kasama dun yung measures for self-quarantine, dapat ma-check up yan. Tapos kung walang uuwi na pamilya yan, dapat may pupuntahan muna yan before, you know, baka kung saan pumunta yan. So, kailangan siguro isipin din yun.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right, Attorney Te, appreciate your time. Thank you very much for speaking with us, and we'll see you after the lockdown.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you.
Salamat po.